Krista Seiden, analytics advocate at Google, and your course instructor for the Google Tag Manager's Fundamentals course on Analytics Academy. Today, I'm joined by Lukas Bergstrom, the product manager for Google Tag Manager. Thank you so much for joining us.
Glad to be here.
Yeah. So today, we're going to go through a bunch of your questions that you guys have submitted in the forum over the past couple weeks. And we've actually had so many great questions come in that we had to split this session out into two. So this is part two of our Q&A session. And if you guys missed part one, be sure to go back and watch part one on the Analytics Academy course page because it's really great content. We went through a lot of really good questions and had a good conversation. It was fun.
Yep, exactly. And actually this time, I'm going to start out with a question for you,
okay.
Which is, I understand that you worked on helping set up Tag Manager for the Analytics Academy site.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell me a little bit about, you know, how you did that and what the benefits of doing that were?
Yeah, definitely. So Tag Manager is a great product, and it's really versatile. So for the course, we mainly focused on showing you Tag Manager for an e-commerce site, our travel adventures website. But it really can be used on any type of site. So we actually have Tag Manager implemented on our course site so that we can measure things like how much of our video content our students are consuming and how people are progressing through various units of the course. So we're getting really, really actionable insights about, the types of things that people are really seeming to like and progress through and what might not be working. And that's going to really help us to build better courses in the future. And it's also helped us to even fix a few problems that we found along the way with this course. So, I love GTM, and it's really proven to be very actionable for us so far in this course. So I think that's really cool.
Glad to hear it.
So, Lukas, I've got a couple questions for you.
Mm-hmm.
I've noticed several questions in the forum around variables.
Yep.
And it seems like there might be a little bit of confusion about kind of what variables are and when you should use them. So could you shed some light on that for us?
Yeah. So a variable is basically a piece of data that you want to use, right, in a tag or in a trigger, right? So if your container is running, if you want to use the URL in the trigger, or if you want to maybe, get the product category to send along with a tag, you're going to use a variable in Tag Manager to kind of capture that value and use it somewhere. And, the kind of variable you're going to create depends on where the data is coming from, right? So if you are getting a value from a DOM element, you're going to want to use a DOM element variable. If you are getting a value that's been pushed to the data layer, you're going to use a data layer variable.
Great. So that actually brings me to my next question, which is kind of similar, and that's really what's the difference between a trigger and a variable?
Right.
Are there some cases where you are using a variable and you could use a trigger, or, how do those two play together?
Yeah, so as I said, like a variable is really a piece of data that you want to use, but on its own, it's not going to do anything. It needs to be kind of used somewhere before it's going to do something.
Right.
A trigger, instead, is something where you're going to kind of look at the value of variables and decide if you want to fire a tag, right? And triggers really are just, they're just looking at stuff and making decisions about whether or not they're gonna fire that tag.
Mm-hmm.
So in terms of the question, like, when am I going to use a variable versus a trigger? I guess, I think I saw this in the forum, and I think what people were talking about was, I've got this container, and I use it on, maybe five different sites, right? And, they're pretty similar, GA tracking setups. So I could either have like five different tags and have the same, have different web property IDs, right? So I set up a trigger that, say, looks at the host name and decides, which tag to fire, right? Mm-hmm. And then so that fires the correct tag, and the tag has the web property ID in it. You can do that. The problem is, if you do any other kind of configuration of the tag, like maybe you're setting up cross-domain tracking or something like that, you're going to have to set it up across five different tags.
Ah.
So if your tracking setup is basically the same across all those different sites, what we recommend instead is populate that web property ID field using a lookup table variable. And what that lets you do is look at the value of a variable, right? Like look at the host name, and depending on what the host name is, return a different value. So you can have one GA tag, right? And then, just populate the web property ID dynamically right? Got based it. On what you want.
So that works if you're sending to only one analytics property at a time, right. And it just may vary which analytics property you want to send to.
Yeah.
But if you want to send to multiple analytics properties from a single page, then you'll still need to have multiple tags.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Yep. Great.
And kind of another question, you know, and we're definitely doing more kind of advanced questions this time around.
Mm-hmm.
What's the best practice if you've already got code on the page that sends GA events, mm-hmm. right? If you move to Tag Manager, should you kind of keep that code in place? Should you move all of it into Tag Manager?
Yep. So that's a great question. And I've actually addressed this in a couple of ways in the various businesses that I've done analytics for as a practitioner. And I think that it really depends on the extent of the event implementation that you have on a website.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have a fairly robust implementation with a lot of events already tracked, I would actually recommend going ahead and leaving those events tags in place.
Mm-hmm.
And that way you can reuse the value of them. So what you would do in that case is you actually just would remove the track event command.
Mm-hmm.
So you're not sending data that's hard-coded to GA directly. And instead, in Google Tag Manager, you're going to build out a tag that has the event category action and label listening for the corresponding values right. of the stuff that you already have on your page. So that actually makes it, it's great for a couple of reasons, right? Because you're reusing a lot of the value that you already have. You're not redoing that effort.
Mm-hmm.
And it also prevents you from having to create a lot of new tags in Tag Manager.
Yep.
But let's say that you have a site that changes a lot, or there's only a couple of events that you need to get up and running fast. You could also do all of those through Tag Manager.
Got it.
And use like a click class variable or something to define when to call those.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense.
So kind of, again, on the more robust, more difficult question track,
mm-hmm.
I've seen a lot of questions in the forum about cross-domain tracking.
Right.
And people want to know what's the advantage of using a single GTM container across domains.
Mm-hmm.
And what's the benefit of it? Is it to combine right. a lot of different page views into a single analytics property, or what's the value?
Right. So kind of two separate things happening there, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the question of like, you know, why would I want to use cross-domain tracking, right? What does it do?
Mm-hmm.
Is a little bit separate from should I use one Tag Manager container on multiple
right.
sites.
Mm-hmm.
And we actually covered in the last session like why you might want to use a single Tag Manager container across
yep.
multiple sites. But as far as cross-domain tracking goes, the way that works is it doesn't kind of combine, you know, it doesn't combine different web properties or different domains into a single report.
Mm-hmm.
What it does is it makes sure that you're correctly counting which visitors came from, you know, outside referrals
right.
versus like internal referrals mm-hmm. on different kind of domains and subdomains.
Yep.
Right. So that makes sure that kind of when you're looking at refers in Google Analytics, that, you know, it's not getting polluted by right,
like, by your own sites.
By your own sites, exactly. And then the other thing that it does is it kind of stitches sessions together correctly,
mm-hmm.
right? So that if you have somebody that moves from, you know, the parent domain to maybe a child domain, right, that looks like a single session.
Yeah. So let's say you had a form that spanned different domains and you wanted to know if people went all the way through that form,
right.
you'd be able to track those people across domains by setting up cross-domain tracking
exactly.
in a single session
exactly.
to see that they completed that goal.
Yep.
Great.
Eh.
Sorry. So I actually had one more question mm-hmm. on cross-domain tracking before we move on. So in the course, we showed an example where we stitched together two different domains
yep.
using the GA cross-domains variable.
Yep.
But what if somebody had 3 or 4 or 5 domains that they wanted to do the same thing with? And also, in addition to that, Does cross-domain tracking take into account subdomains already, or is there anything else that people need to do for that?
Right. So as far as like subdomain tracking goes, as long as you have the cookie domain set to auto,
mm-hmm.
right, then you've already ensured that subdomain tracking is going to work fine from the parent domain.
Works out of the box as
yeah.
long as you have that set to auto.
Yeah, exactly.
Perfect.
So then the but if you need to do kind of additional stuff, right, you've got like multiple domains that you need to manually specify,
mm-hmm.
right, like using that GA cookie domains variable,
mm-hmm.
you can actually put multiple domains in there just separated by commas, right? There is a limitation. If you create a variable, it can
right.
only be like
255 characters.
255
right?
characters.
So what happens if you hit that?
Right. So it, any single variable can only be that big, but mm-hmm. you can actually put multiple variables in that field when you're configuring the GA tag.
Okay.
And to separate those by commas. Right?
So basically you would create like a GA crossdomains 1, GA crossdomains 2, multiple variables, and you'd put them all together in that variables field.
Yeah, exactly.
Awesome.
Yep.
Cool.
So switching from kind of cross-domain tracking to more of kind of an e-commerce set of questions. Mm-hmm. In the course, you collect trip value using a custom dimension rather than using the enhanced e-commerce features. Can you tell people, you know, why you did that, when you might want to choose one or the other?
Yeah, definitely. So I did notice there was a lot of questions on this in the forum. Some really astute students out there who recognized that we could have actually have done the same thing with an enhanced e-commerce. So GA actually has a very robust feature set in the form of enhanced e-commerce that you can implement on any kind of an e-commerce store, or really on any kind of a site. I've seen it done for blogs too. Pretty interesting use cases. Hmm. But in the case of the course, we actually just wanted to collect one value and send it as a custom metric to Google Analytics first. So for simplicity, we did it without enhanced e-commerce. We actually have a course on e-commerce for the Analytics Academy. So we didn't want to reinvent that wheel. Mm-hmm. But also it allowed us to show you an example of collecting a value with the data layer and sending it to a custom metric in Google Analytics. So there was a few reasons. But I think it's really great that people kind of pointed that out and recognized that there's multiple ways to do this.
Yep. That makes sense.
Yep. So I have another question about form tracking. I know we talked about it a little bit earlier for cross-domains, but what if you have a contact form and you want to track abandonment through GTM with goal funnels and analytics? Mm-hmm. How would you recommend setting this up?
Right. So what we're talking about is somebody who kind of starts filling out a form, right, and then leaves it.
Exactly.
Yeah. So if you're going to do this using just standard analytics, you're going to need to send virtual page views to mm-hmm. kind of indicate when someone starts, you know, typing in a field.
Yep.
Right. If you're a premium customer, you can actually send events and then use our custom funnels feature, mm-hmm. right, which is pretty useful. Yeah. But most of you are going to have to use virtual page views. Mm-hmm. So what we recommend is because we don't, unfortunately, have a trigger right now that tells you when someone starts typing in a field, mm-hmm. you're actually going to have code on the page that pushes an event to the data layer. Right. And we recommend doing that on the on change event, mm-hmm. right, rather than the on focus. Because if they're just kind of tabbing through all the fields, you don't want to necessarily
too many extra like, hits.
Count that. Yeah.
Right. On change actually lets GA know that field was actually changed. Somebody entered something in the field rather than tabbing through.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So if you have access to the code on the page, you can, you know, change the on change handlers for those different fields to have them push a kind of a virtual an event to the data layer, and then have a GA tag that takes that event and fires a virtual page view. Mm-hmm. If you don't have access to the code on the page, there is a solution if you're kind of more comfortable with JavaScript. Mm-hmm. And there are people that have written guides on kind of how to use a custom HTML tag
right.
to insert some code in the page that'll kind of do this event tracking for you. So you can kind of Google around for that if that's something that you're more comfortable doing.
Yeah.
And then kind of speaking of like triggers, definitely when people are setting up click tracking or form submit tracking, mm-hmm. they sometimes get confused about why there's kind of an enable when section and then also a fire on
yep.
section. Can you maybe talk about the difference between those two?
Yeah, definitely. So I understand why this could be confusing. But the main difference between enable when and fire on is really about when we start listening for what's happening versus when we're actually sending that event. So for example, if you only cared about a form that was submitted on, let's say, on your about page, mm-hmm. You would actually set the trigger to enable when or to start listening only when the about.com page was up. And then you would actually trigger the form button, the submit button being sent. So you would fire on mm-hmm. When that button was clicked. So
right.
that's the main difference, is just when you listen for it versus when you actually send it.
Got it. And since we recommend that you kind of like test this stuff before you publish it live by kind of, you know, saying enable on, you know, just this page or just these pages, mm-hmm. you kind of limit the number of pages you have to test
yep.
right? Because it's not going to be listening for anything at all.
Right.
Unless that happens. So that makes sense.
Cool. Definitely. So I think that's about all we have time for in part two of the session. But before we close out, I wanted to address one last question. Mm-hmm. So I've seen a lot of people in the forum asking about the course completion certificate. And if completing this GTM Fundamentals course on Analytics Academy was the same or the equivalent of the GA IQ exam. So it's not the same. It's not the equivalent. The GA IQ exam is actually a much more robust exam. And we're looking at potentially having something similar in the future for GTM. But for now, it's not the same. And also, if you're a partner, I've seen a lot of questions about partners who are interested to know if the Fundamentals course certified them as a partner for GTM. And the answer there, again, is no. We have actually a partner certification process through the GACP program. Right. So if you're interested, if you're a partner and you're interested in getting certified for GTM, I definitely reach out to the GACP program and you can find out more information that way.
Cool.
So with that, I want to thank you guys all again so much for joining us. I think this has been an incredible set of questions and a conversation that we've been able to have over these last couple of videos.
Yep.
And I also wanted to remind you guys one last time of all of the resources that we have. So again, we have so many great resources with the Analytics Academy. There's Digital Analytics Fundamentals and Platform Principles. We mentioned e-commerce. There's a course for that. And there's also a course for mobile. So definitely a wealth of knowledge that you guys can go out and study through the Analytics Academy. Additionally, we have a lot of blog resources. So Google Analytics is a great blog to follow. They blog about a lot of things for GA and GTM. Mm-hmm. And I actually also have a blog that I blog a lot about GA and GTM.
Yep.
And that's bloggerchica.com.
Yep. And we also have a couple social media accounts you might want to follow if you mm-hmm. want to get more frequent updates. You can on Google Plus follow Google Analytics at plus Google Analytics, yep. and you'll actually get Tag Manager news as well as analytics news. Mm-hmm. And if you're on Twitter, it's at Google Analytics.
Yep.
And Krista, you actually have your own Twitter account, right?
I do. It's at Krista Seiden mm-hmm. on Twitter. And Lukas, I think you're at Lukas B.
That's right.
So with that, thank you guys so much for joining us, and happy tagging.